13th, 1877. The evening is quiet in the 8th Ward. The people who traverse these streets move quickly and quietly, neither speaking to me or to each other. But their mission is clear. Find the evil that lurks here. It will not take the innocent long to find his required and particular brand of sin, for the degradation is everywhere. In the face of an orphan child, in the hungry look of a scarlet woman, in the gleaming blade of a gang member. When one has discovered his chosen immorality for the evening, he will revel in its sordid depravity. He will wallow in its sensuous horror. It is part and parcel of life in the 8th Ward, a place more notorious than San Francisco's Tenderloin, and more hellacious than New York City's Five Points. It is an area of our city that is fairly alive with sin and degradation. So alive, one can feel the evil's fetid breathing.
Nice flowery words for a guy who's never been there.
I wrote what I heard from people who should know.
Which amounts to hearsay, Willie. Gotta have proof to be in print.
Then let me go down there. I'll write you a story that'll blow the lid off
anything. Same old song and dance. You just stick to the garden parties and social events like you're assigned.
Mr. Fremont, I want to experience death firsthand.
You want to get close to death? I'll let you write the obituaries.
It has come to the attention of this reporter that the only possible means of ridding the capital city of the blight which plagues it is to burn it to the ground and sprinkle salt over the scorched earth, so that nothing evil may ever again grow there. Hold up! What body?
The body down in the ward.
It's been a murder in the 8th Ward.
Murder!
Take their statements.
Oh, do I now?
Are you telling me how to do my job, young fella?
No, I wouldn't presume to tell a policeman such a thing.
Well, good, then I won't have to tell you how to do yours. You just be sure and spell the name right. McCleary. Clyde, you best haul the so-called witnesses down to the station. I suppose we better make this one look good for the newspaper.
He wasn't doing nothing but walking quietly. Them boys came right up to him.
Would you like to make a statement to the press?
Her? There's a lad. Nobody would believe a whore like her. She can't be trusted any further than she can be thrown.
I'll make a statement. I'll tell you anything and everything. If you buy a girl a drink. Folks call me Prissy. Short for Priscilla. But, you can call me Gertrude or Genevieve or teeny with the light brown hair if that's what you fancy. And looks like you might could fancy any one of them names.
Hey, Prissy, don't mean to disrupt your business. I was just looking for my knife. Carry on like I wasn't even here. There it is.
Your knife.
You're the one who killed that man. Not me, mister. I ain't no killer. Just loaned this here knife out to a friend. Billy Jelly's the name. No one knows the war better than me. That's the work of the Bridge Street gang.
To which he don't belong. They say he's too much of a coward to be a member.
Don't want to belong to no street gang. All them just end up dead or in prison. Bunch of worthless low lives. I want to be a gent. Like your friend here. All dressed up fine and stylish like. Bet he's even got a real job. I'm a reporter for the Patriot.
And he ain't no friend. At least not yet.
I've really got to be going. I've got to get the story into my editor. Wait! What story? About this murder? Hell and damnation, man, that ain't no great news in the war. Just some poor sod in the wrong place at the right time.
This ain't the first murder here, and it ain't gonna be the last.
You want a story for your paper? You need to see things firsthand. Life in the Eighth Ward.
Stories that'll curl your toes.
Tales to make a real man out of. From the outside looking in, it's just one big den of sin. What with adultering cards and booze.
If you want a lurid tale to leave your readers one and pale,
and your senses to assail, here's where you'll find the news. The bloody. Of sheer brutalities, the bloody age.
The bloody age.
A lovely Eden of depravity and lust, where a person's own dear mother is an object of disgust.
A place where all the preachers soon and noise, and the religious folk can moralize, where the inhabitants just terrorize.
The bloody age.
Do it unto you,
the bloody age.
The
stay out after dark. You want a story for your paper? Just take a look, see around the ward.
She's cheap looking. A gent like you needs a lady like me with class.
Of course, if she ever came to class in grammar school.
Oh, fresh fruit today, fresh fruit. Oh, Mrs. Weisberger, how about some nice fresh apples? You make a nice apple kugel for Saul.
Not firm, darling. An apple should be firm.
Oh, Mrs. Klein, you know me how long? 5, 10, 20 years. Oh, then I should sell you inferior fruit. I should be struck dead right here in the streets of this devil.
He's right, Miriam. After all, his son Jonah married your daughter Ruth. A perfect match. Oh, and such a wedding you had. Oh, you were like the Queen of England.
Oh, you think so? Well then, Mr. Schloss, since your family, I'll take a dozen. No worms, though. You charge extra for the worms, no?
How fresh are these apples? Picked today, I bet you'll tell me.
Oh, what? You want I should pick them tomorrow? Of course I pick them today.
Yeah, picked today from the front of my grocer.
Oh, no, I stole apples.
My daughter Zay, you saw you steal them.
Oh, this you can prove. What? Your name is imprinted on this apple.
Faith, good of the life of me, da. I dragged the poor sot right under the table.
Make a finnegan. Your spinning tail's taller than a cathedral in Dublin. Twere no old sod. Twas a barmaid. I'd carry you home, make a sack of potatoes.
Not the way I remember it all. She had eyes for me. Did you see how she was staring?
Evening, boys. How about a party with my friend and me?
Oh, there you go, Mrs. Klein. A dozen apples, no worms. That'll be 35 cents.
35 cents? With sugar? Mrs. Grant's apples are cheaper. Those are my apples, and that Jew stole them.
Oh, this you can prove. What? You brought them with you from Africa. Oh, come on.
I still say that barmaid was a sot better looking than these two trollops.
From now on to Mrs. Grant's I go. The quality is so much better.
But the price, Miriam, you can't beat the price. 35 cents.
It ain't so bad if into your life some quiet little rain must pour. You can find some solace
with any two big filthy whores. Let's find some heaven in this sorry vale of tears, where an honest man is not what he appears.
Something that might perk your readers' imaginations?
Well, I have
arguing Jews, arguing Irishmen, and arguing Negroes. Not exactly front page news, Billy. And what would you be considering front page news?
Exciting things. The sort of things that are going to make people sit up and take notice.
Hell and damnation, man. There ain't nothing exciting here. People come, people go, sure as a river's steady flow. They know it's the way God intended for them to live and die. Nothing to brag about, there ain't nothing exciting here. Ain't no flowers, ain't no trees, people do whatever they please. They know it's the way God intended them to live and
hotel would be such a nuisance.
There's someone you want to get away from. Come on, I'll take you over to Lafayette Hall.
Did someone say Lafayette Hall?
I'm afraid that was my companion here.
Indeed. And what would you know about it?
A
Not to know it's a better place than yours will be.
As if one den of iniquity could be better than another. And you would be?
Wilson Kenley, reporter.
Hello, kind sir. Allow me to introduce myself.
Alfred Garner, impresario.
And hotelier.
Whorehouse manager, more likely.
Bitter, are we? Tell me, Mr. Kenley, what brings you to our little slice of heaven we call the Eighth Ward?
Looking for news?
Mr. Garner's got news. He's opened a brand new establishment, the Red Lion.
Freddy, please. I'm totally capable of tooting my own horn. Thank you very much. As my overly eager employee just said, I am planning on opening a brand new establishment.
An establishment?
The likes which no man in the Eighth Ward has seen here before. It will dazzle the senses, delight any eye. Any man will be drawn and is just passing by. He'll experience sensuous pleasures, the likes of which he'll have not had before. Try to picture it, Mr. Kenley, if you can. Just look in your mind, and slowly you open the door. A palace of sin, a hotel of pleasure, a drink or a game, a nice looking game for a man of leisure. The chairs are all filled with men. Have one great ambition to try out their luck at cards without one inhibition. A castle of sport, a house of enjoyment. Let yourself go, it's quite apropos to caress every moment. Any sin you require. Salon of seducement, where a girl can be had, where she can be bad with a little inducement. A room for two to have that special assignation. Quite private without a worry or a confrontation. A building so vile, of gross degradation. Visit a while and you leave with a smile. You have felt each sensation. So if you have the time for committing some crime, come and feel the sublime at my palace of sin. You will want an encore when you find what's in store right beyond the front door. Of my palace of sin. Freddy, go and fetch the carriage. Mr. Kenley, I trust you have some new insightful information for your readers.
I'm not sure how much of this I'll be able to get into print. You see, my editor is kind
of sensitive. Of course he is. All the news that's fit to print, right? Well, I trust you will do what you can to help me out on this new venture. Even bad publicity is better than no publicity.
I'm sure there's some story I can come up with.
I have great respect and great trust in the printed word, even if it is the Patriot.
Come on, Kenley. You don't want to be seen talking to this guy.
Is something troubling you?
You're just opening another But it ain't going to be no classy house like what Mr. Cook's got.
I should say not. Lafayette Hall is a gilded palace of sin. The place looks like a poor man's Versailles. Gilded mirrors, imported chandeliers, even a piano from Mr. Steinway in New York. And what is it all for?
I should say he's trying to make a rather flashy showing.
Exactly my point. All those ornamentations and flounces and furbelows are a distraction because he cannot offer the men of this city what they really want. And what they really want is unadulterated pleasure. I intend to give them that. The Red Lion will offer everything I promise. It will far surpass the carnality of New York or the banality of Baltimore.
Men don't want that.
Oh, they do. They really do. They just don't know it yet.
Bigger's a fine example of low life living the high life. No class, no manners, and no breed. He seemed like a fine cut of a fellow, although his new establishment is sure to raise a few eyebrows. You're kidding me, right? What? Do you think anyone's gonna notice one more house like that here in the ward? How long you been in the eighth? About 30 minutes. That's it? Coming here was not high on my places to visit, and even if it was, it's nothing any self-respecting man would admit to. I came here looking for a story, and so far I have the murder in the ward and the upcoming opening of a bordello. I'm sure that the mayor is going to be absolutely appalled when he reads about it. When he reads about it? He spends more time down here than he does in his office. Or then the city council. The state senators? Don't tell me. The governor. I haven't seen him yet, but it's only a matter of time before he falls under the spell of this place.
The bloody eighth, a slice of heaven in this sorry veil of tears, where an honest man is not what he appears to be.
Where acts of right and good propriety can be affected by sobriety.
Constituents actually expect me to enforce the damn bill. It's unbelievable, isn't it? They vote you into office and they expect to think that you'll do what you ask you to.
Next thing you know, they'll be wanting us to clean up the Eighth Ward.
Well, yes, that'll happen when the moon turns green and hell freezes over.
Yes. Well, let's hope that it never gets quite that cold.
I trust the senators are enjoying themselves this evening.
Oh, very much, Mr. Cook. Fine drink, beautiful women. What else could a state senator ask for, hmm?
No, bigger payoff, perhaps?
Touché, Harry, touché.
Yes.
What's all that noise about over there?
Yes, Harry, really. Just can't two gentlemen have a quiet evening in Harrisburg without a ruckus?
Sorry. You know, if I'd wanted to hear this type of trash, I could have stayed home and talked with my wife. If you'll excuse me, please. Melvin, what is the problem here?
It's Mr. Doxer. He's wanting to charge another bottle to his tab.
That's right, Cook. And make a compliment to the house. I lose enough money playing faro and poker in this place. You can afford it.
I'm afraid that isn't possible, sir.
Then put it on my tab.
Oh, your tab is rather high, Mr. Doc. Much as you are right now.
Listen to him. The big fancy man in his fancy clothes. In his fancy whorehouse. Don't you talk to me like I was one of your lackeys, Cook. There are other places I could go to.
Well, then perhaps a change of scenery would be best advised for one and all.
You're throwing me out.
Oh, not at all, Mr. Dobbs. I'm asking you to leave without any embarrassment.
Oh, don't you worry, Cook. I wouldn't dream of causing a scene in a place like this.
Very good.
Plenty of other places would gladly take my money. Thank you for a most memorable evening. It's the first time I've been thrown out of any establishment in the Eighth Ward. Watch where you're going, sir. Are you drunk?
Ah, Billy. I see you've brought a friend with you this evening. Welcome, sir, to Lafayette Hall.
Mr. Garner was right. This is a gilded palace. You're Mr. Cook, aren't you?
Oh, an astute observation, my friend, on both counts. Yes, I built this place to eclipse anything in this special line of business that had been seen here tofore in Harrisburg. Did I hear you mention the name of Alfred Garner?
Yes, I did, sir. I met him earlier while I was covering a murder story. He wanted me to do a story about the upcoming opening of his new establishment next week.
Yes, well, I wish him well.
The ward can always use another establishment, as you so tactfully put it. Frankly, he doesn't bother me. I cater to a much better class of men.
Perhaps a little competition will be good for business?
Oh, please, please, Billy. Business, as you say, is far from dull. The fools are never all dead at once. And the worst fools in the whole bunch are the gray-headed fools and the bald-headed fools that go into their second childhood and get killed. Still and all, then, money is just as good as the upriver Yankees. What say we have a glass and make a toast to free enterprise in our fair city? Melvin, bring several drinks for our new friends. And may I make a suggestion? We could go downstairs where we could be more comfortable.
Downstairs? That's where the restaurant is, and upstairs is a free and easy dance hall. Quite the setup you have here, Mr. Cook.
Indeed.
Here are your drinks, gentlemen. The house specialty.
Ah, excellent. Thank you, Melvin. I should like to propose a toast. Gentlemen! Gentlemen! Here's to good times, good money, and bad women. Long may they wait!
Cheers!
Oh, keep a stiff upper lip, Junior. The worst will soon be over.
What was that awful stuff?
Some men have survived several doses.
But what was it?
It's a special brand of whiskey found only prior to an election.
Yes, and should a customer have enough of it to drink, why, you can pretty much get him to vote for anybody.
Hear, hear.
Mr. Cook!
Ah, Sergeant. Such a pleasure to see you, although you are somewhat early for your, monthly raid.
Never mind, Cook. I hope you're not selling any alcohol in here. You know you don't have a license anymore.
No, of course not. A mere formality, a misunderstanding down at the Capitol. I'm assured I shall have my license back within a fortnight.
I would bully for you. In the meantime, no liquor to any of your patrons, including the good Senator Greensboro over there. No offense, Senator.
And I assure you there's no offense taken in the clearing.
I knew I recognized you.
Yes, perhaps we should introduce ourselves.
This is Mr. Wilson Kenley.
Oh, I see.
An investigative reporter with the Patriots.
Oh, I see. Well, I'm just making my rounds in the district, make sure the constituents know I'm about there.
Oh, relax, sure. Oliver, relax. I'm sure Mr. Kenley will have only kind things to say about us. Won't you, Mr. Kenley? Now, Sergeant, we were about to have supper. Would you care to join us as my guest, of course?
No, I'm on duty. Been a murder down in the ward. Looks like the Bridge Street gang's handiwork.
Yes, ever since that bridge was constructed, that group of hellions has been meeting there.
Oh, they're even worse than the 16 bleeders.
Absolutely. That State Street bridge has become a nuisance with all those gangs holding high carnival day and night, rioting and robbing. I'll tell you, as a state senator, it's my job to see that we shut that place down as soon as we possibly can.
You can get down off the soapbox. This ain't an election year.
We mustn't keep you from your appointed round, Sergeant. And may I make this contribution to the Benevolent Association?
Oh, that's very generous of you, Mr. Cook. I know exactly where to put this.
Yeah, in his pocket. That policeman just took a bribe, didn't he? Now you're getting the idea of this place.
We can relax now, gentlemen. Melvin, I believe fresh bottles of champagne would be appropriate. All right.
Have some entertainment. Maybe a song.
Excellent, Senator. Perhaps we can persuade one of our girls to favor us.
Mr. Kenley, you're in for a real treat now. This is my girl that's about to sing.
Your girl?
I gotta tell a more about a charming girl. So many years ago, she really was a girl. Good girl, that little Nellie. She was a mulatto.
music play. So she went right on in. The men all looked at her, and one began to grin. He was a banker old, and he approached the lass with manner brash and bold. He said, let's have a glass of liquor cheap and strong. Reluctantly she did, and down the road to ruin. That sweet young Nellie slid, she was a good, good girl, that little Nellie. She was a blossom waiting to be picked. She was a beauty, quite a looker, don't you dare call her a hooker. She was good, 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 that little Nell. Another gent I heard liked everything he saw, although he was as old as son of grandpapa. He bought her furs and clothes, just almost anything, but something was amiss. There was no wedding ring. When Nelly told the man she really wanted one, the guy replied to her, why, it would spoil the fun. But she replied, I want to be an honest mate. He sneered and said to her, a wife does not get paid. Now there's a moral here. Don't be like little Nell. It isn't worth the price to be a Jezebel. Don't ever misbehave. Keep your virtue strong, or you might just end up in one more barroom song. She was a good girl, that little Nelly. She was a blossom waiting to be picked. She was a beauty, quite a looker. Don't you dare call her a hooker. She was good, 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 that little.
You have a way with the song.
Excuse me. My name is Wilson Kenley.
Oh, good God, where are my manners? Mr. Kenley, this is Miss Cecilia Henderson.
Mr. Kenley? Mr. Kenley?
Oh, I'm delighted to meet you. I really enjoyed your song. I think you're really quite beautiful.
Excuse us, Mr. Kenley. Listen, it's almost settled. After next week, you will no longer be working here.
Oh, Oliver. Oh, I knew if I waited around long enough, you would do it.
Do what? What are you talking about? You actually, you actually think I would jeopardize everything and marry you? I've worked too hard for all these things. No, that is not possible as of yet.
Then when will it be right? The 10th of never?
Oh, you must be patient, Cecilia. After all, good things come to all those who wait. Now, as I was saying to you, you'll no longer be working here. Next week, you'll be starting at the Red Lawn.
Garner's place?
Yes, Garner's place. I have a considerable amount of money invested in his place. And in return, he is going to provide a private home for you to live in. No more singing for your supper, as it were. And of course, it will be much, much more private for you.
Don't you mean more private for you? Everyone at the ward sees you coming and going from all hours from this place. Well, your dirty little secret will finally be just that. What if I won't do what you propose? If I don't want to sing there, maybe I won't be singing anywhere.
You'll sing, all right. You'll do what I tell you. Because I own you. Lock, stock, and barrel. Now, do you want to end up back on the street where I found you?
Excuse me. Is there a problem here?
Nothing to concern yourself with, young man, I'm sure.
Thank you for your concern, Mr. Kenley, but I am not in need of any assistance. I can take care of myself quite nicely.
Cecilia! Cecilia!
Gentlemen, I have returned! Please, try to contain your enthusiasm. I am to be congratulated. I've been thrown out of 3 places tonight. I believe I've set a new record. Melvin, I should like a table for one. Mother decided to stay home.
I don't want any more trouble tonight. Mr. Cook said you are no longer welcome here. I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to leave. Again.
Very well. I shall leave your premises. Never will I darken your... Seeming a little short for a handsome cab. Could you lend me a few dollars?
Please go, Mr. Doc, before Mr. Cook returns.
Come along, Mr. Doc. We'll see that you get home.
Bless you, sir. Good Samaritan helping the weary traveler. Bless you and your young charge, too.
It smells like a distillery.
Oh, forgive me, sir. I have been drinking. Liquor is my one true weakness, and drinking is my favorite pastime.
Perhaps you should find another hobby. Can you tell us where you live?
Certainly. I live in a house. A big house with my mater. It's referred to as a mansion.
I mean the address.
Oh. You take North Street past the reservoir all the way down to front. Make a left and go down to Walnut. It's the big house that looks like a library. Now, shall we get ourselves a hansom?
I think a nice long walk might be a better idea.
And we'll drink as we go. You know, I hate to drink alone, and I'm not moving from the spot until you both join me.
Well, I'd like a drink or two as well as the next man.
Now, listen, boys, I can be very stubborn when I'm sober. Go on. It won't kill you. Good. A nice long swallow. Now you.
Mr. Doc, do you ever...
Call me Jasper. All my drinking pals do.
All right, Jasper. Do you ever stop drinking?
Only when I'm sleeping. And since I seem to be relatively awake, I believe I shall have another snort. We have to finish this before we get home. Mother will have a royal conniption if she sees me with a bottle. More?
Don't you do anything besides drink?
I don't have the time. No one's visiting all the drinking establishments in the city. I'm much too busy. Tap house, ale house, tavern, pub, gin mill or saloon. Any place that's got itself a brass rail and a clean spittoon. Point me to a swinging door, barkeep, fill it up. The one thing that I know, I love to watch that liquor flow. The world looks better from the bottom of a cup.
Lager, porter, stout or beer for the common man. How they love that rugged taste, quenches like no water can. Mugs of frothy amber ale, watch them drink it up.
See a strong, hard-working gent, it's better with his elbow bent. And the world looks better from the bottom of a cup.
Of my guests. You have to bring along your friends to help you do it.
Discuss, Mummy. These gentlemen were kind enough to see me safely home. Gentlemen, I bid you a fond farewell and a pleasant good evening. It was a pleasure. Even if I don't remember your names.
Well, thank you for seeing my so-called son home. It's better than having to send the butler down to pick him up.
Oh, Mara. Lovely, lovely party. I truly enjoyed it. Kenley, is that you?
Good evening, Mr. Fremont.
Do you know this young man?
Why, unfortunately, I do. He works for me.
Looks like Jasper will be in the papers again.
Oh, good heavens. You wouldn't do that to me, would you?
Of course he won't.
The movement can't afford one iota of bad press. It could ruin everything.
What movement? Ruin what? Oh, nothing for you to be concerned about, boy.
Well, these two have a right to know. Perhaps they might even join us.
True, true. One more crusader for reform.
How do you spell safer? Kenley, I think you've done enough for one night. I'll see you at 8 a.m. sharp at the office. Good night.
Mr. Freeman.
I said good night.
I say we ask the young man to join us.
Oh, he's right, Daniel. There's not many young people that are interested in what we're trying to do.
We shall see what comes about, what develops, what occurs. We can ask him later if we need his assistance.
One can never have too much assistance when one is dealing with this gross corruption.
And drinking.
And pleasures of the flesh.
We shall see.
And we are agreed, gentlemen. The march will occur 1 week from tonight.
We shall clean up the Eighth Ward.
And bring a message of hope to if it happens.
We shall see what happens when we storm the gate and bring respite to the minions of disgrace. We shall see what passes when we free the huddled masses and we rid the city of that place. We're the true good people who will march into the fray. It's a blessed and invigorating feeling. We're the true good people who have come to save the day and will vanquish all the sin we are revealing. We shall see what happens when we battle there and we rip them from the lives to which they cling. When the souls have been removed and the way of life be proved, then the bell of freedom shall ring. And the just. It's protection we fight under. We will tear their lies asunder, breaking through the chains of carnal lust.
We're the true, good people who are marching to the fray. It's a blessed and invigorating feeling. We're the true, good people who have come to save the day and will vanquish all the sin we are revealing.
Senator Greensboro. He was an odd sort of fellow, said he was looking after his constituents, but I knew what he was really looking after.
And how did you come upon Jasper, Doc?
He came into the Lafayette and was asked to leave, and since he was in no condition to see himself home,
I just thought you'd offer your services.
I had no idea he was the son of the Mrs. Doc.
I know you didn't. I read through your journal, and you certainly made a night of it. It's no wonder you weren't involved in a brawl.
Sir, I think I have the makings of a fine story. Perhaps a series of stories about the Eighth Ward. I can have the first installment ready tomorrow.
There will be no first installment, or any other installment for that matter. The Patriot will not be party to causing a citywide uproar.
But sir, the whole city already knows about the ward.
Oh, they know about it all right. In their mind, they've made a fantasy picture of it in their mind's eye, but reading about it in black and white makes it a reality, and they don't want to know it exists.
Mr. Fremont,
the matter is closed. The public can imagine whatever they like. Leave it that way. Your new assignment is posted. Good afternoon.
We shall see what comes about, what develops, what occurs, when one is dealing with this gross corruption. We shall see.
Damn it!
I beg your pardon?
I wasn't speaking to you, I was just... Miss Henderson. Good afternoon. What a pleasant surprise. Are you alone?
Yes, occasionally I do find a few spare moments for myself. And you needn't worry about the senator. He's either at the Senate building or he's at home pretending to be head of the family.
I must say, you're being very candid.
You and I are both adults and aware of, shall we say, my situation. I'm not embarrassed, nor should you be. Now, shall we talk about the weather, or perhaps you'd like to discuss your latest journalistic effort?
I didn't know you read the paper. Well, that is, I didn't know that a girl like you would be interested in finding...
Yes, Mr. Kenley. Occasionally I do find the Patriot amusing and entertaining, even for a common girl like me.
That's not what I meant. I wanted to say that well, you see that... Damn it!
Something wrong?
No. Yes. Miss Henderson, I'm going to have to be very candid with you as well, and you'll have to forgive my rudeness, as I hardly know you, yet I am aware of your existence.
Oh, and I yours, thanks to the newspaper.
Please, don't interrupt. This is extremely difficult for me. I want to tell you that...
Mr. Kenley, are you all right? Should I get you a doctor?
You have a devastating effect on me. I spend my life, such as it is, using words. And whenever I'm around you, I can... Well, the words don't seem... I can't possibly be making any sense to you.
You make perfect sense, Mr. Kenley. And I'm flattered. It isn't every day a woman gets the attention from a man of letters.
Good afternoon, Miss Henderson.
Listen, Mr. Kenley, I'm not teasing you if that's what you're thinking. I meant what I said sincerely. Please forgive me.
Forgive me.
Good. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have some errands I must attend to. Thank you for the pleasant conversation. Good afternoon.
Perhaps we shall meet again.
Yes, perhaps. Wednesday, April 17th, 1877. Visiting the Eighth Ward today proved to be a great source of enlightenment and happiness. Having met and personally spoken to one of its residents, I can say in all honesty that these are a good and pleasant people. While some detractors might say, remove this malignancy, I say live and let live.
God led his people through the desert and the storm, and God is helping me. From the Pharaoh he delivered us with the parting of the big Red Sea.
He gave us manna when we nearly died, 10 commandments we had to obey.
It is, oy vey.
We may be poor, but we've got energy and industry. We're picking rags and sorting other people's junk. We live in squalor with our relatives. Our little piece of heaven sure has shrunk. We live our holy life just like our learned ancestors, fighting all the pagan tribes that we're now. We would rather fight in Jericho and hear the mighty trumpet blow than live here in Pennsylvania's hell.
Then move out and leave us alone!
Thursday, April 18th, 1877. The residents of the ward are a melting pot of peoples and cultures. Degradation is common to all of them. And although disgraceful vice conditions are in evidence, it is also the home of many noble men and women whose unsullied lives shine all the more brightly by the contrast.
Need some lenore, St. Matty will lead us each day. And once or twice daily we'll use our shillelagh, so better stay out of our way. Fighting and drinking is fun, we're thinking, so fill up our glasses again.
Then make a toast and forgive our run host, the Irish are men among men.
And they're just a bunch of drunks!
Finnegan, Donegan, Quinlan, O'Halloran, Haggerty, Finnerty, too. We're from Erin, but still we're not caring to have to share land with the Jew!
Thursday, April 23rd, 1877. With the opening of the Red Lion establishment this Saturday past, the city's Negro businessmen are taking their fair share of business. Throughout the ward, colored denizens are regarded with new respect as merchants of trade and industry.
We can vote like the white folk can, we can vote. We are free according to the paper Lincoln wrote. We can vote, we got schools for all our children, and our charges take your pick. But the biggest hardship that we face is sharing land with the Jew or mix.
Monday, April 29th, 1877. Whatever social, economical, and financial differences there are amongst these peoples, one element exists which unites them all in the great American principles of community and communality.
Still writing in your little book?
I am. It's a free country the last time I checked.
Didn't old man Fremont tell you to forget writing about the war?
He did. I write what is assigned to me and turn it in well before my deadlines. I am doing this on my own time. I plan on turning it all into a book.
I was just headed over to the Red Lion. Care to tag along?
Sure, I could always use a healthy dose of depravity. You wouldn't be having any other reason for going there, would you?
Hardly, it's just my continuing research.
Would her name be Cecilia, continuing research?
Lily Jelly, I will thank you not to impugn my standards as a journalist. I would just be going to... Now, if you would just let me defend my motives...
Your motives are honorable. A far sight more honorable than most men I know, but you do mention her name a lot.
Only out of concern for her well-being.
She's got a rich old senator. Her being is well enough.
Billy Jelly, I will thank you not to make light of Miss Henderson.
Face facts, Kenley. You wear your heart on your sleeve. A blind man could see him a mile away. That woman is bad news for any man.
I know what I'm doing, Billy. Now, if you will just excuse me.
Kenley, the Lion's down this way.
I'm not going to the Lion. I'm going home.
What will that prove?
It will prove that while I find Cecilia Henderson attractive, I am not pining over her like some 19th century Romeo. Good night.
Didn't mean to offend you, Kenley. Just calling it like I see it.
What does he know about it? Who's wearing his heart on his sleeve? Where's the problem he talks about? Where's the trouble he perceives? Maybe there's something in what he says, in the things he really believes. But I know myself and the way that I feel. Am I really that naive? There's many things I've seen tonight. A way of life you can't ignore. Surprisingly enough, in the middle of it all, there lives a person. No, not a person. In the midst of the dirt, in the middle of the poor, lives a rose, a ravishing rose. It seems it is there, with no other place to grow, I suppose. People walk, pass around, never looking at the ground, but she's there, that ravishing rose. And she stands there serene, with her loveliness unseen, I suppose. If a rose can brighten a garden, then she lights up the world I see. Loving her makes you lonely, and lonely is what I shall be. In the soft fading light, in the quiet of the night, she is there, that ravishing rose. And she stands there alone, midst the thistle and the stone, and the world will know some beauty, I suppose. Before her colors fade away, I'd like to spend one glorious day and feel the softness that my arms enclose. And then, like the world, I would know some beauty, I suppose.
Clarence! Somebody call the cops! Don't take a stormy warning!
I tell you, the city council's threatened to come in here and wipe out this entire area. And that won't do your hotel or any of this little side businesses any good.
I have heard this song and dance before, McCleary. Idle threats and empty talk.
Not this time. They got old Lady Dot and her cronies are breathing down their neck. Why, they're threatening to come down here themselves and tear this place apart, board by rotten board if necessary.
The council knows the Bloody Eighth put this city on the map, with the talk of every city, town, and village between here and St. Louis.
Good Lord, Garner, your place is wide open, notoriously wide open. The authorities will not put up with such a blatant disrespect for good morals.
And you expect me to deny it? I'm a man of strong moral impulses, sir. But it cuts my heart to see how certain residents of the Red Lion scoff at me. Oh, it hurts me to see how they've degraded themselves and the disgrace they've brought to my hotel. Yet I love these wicked residents, and I tell them so again and again.
Oh, yes. It is a very delicate situation with no cure. Unless? Well, unless something was doing in a pecuniary line.
An awfully big word for such a simple man. Tell me, Sergeant, how much will it take to grease the squeaky axles of the political machine?
Well, as you say, Mr. Garner, I'm a simple man with simple tastes, but this one's gonna take an awful lot to grease.
That ought to do it.
Yes, I should say so.
I trust I can consider you now in my employ.
Oh, you most certainly can. This is a hell of a lot more than I was getting from Cook.
Cook's paying you off too?
Yes. But we fell behind a couple months ago, and the right boys down at the licensing bureau didn't get paid off, so they yanked this liquor selling license. Don't you worry, Garner. I know where my bread's buttered now. You'll see.
We shall see what comes about, what develops, what occurs, when one is dealing with this gross corruption.
Good evening, Mr. Garner. Out for your constitutional?
Yes, Senator. Miss Henderson, you are enjoying your new accommodations?
It's fine.
Cecilia, please. Don't be rude to our friend.
He's your friend, Oliver. You made the deal with the devil, not me.
Cecilia.
Senator, don't bother about it. We all got what we want, one way or the other.
Would like if you would not insult our business partner.
He's your business partner. I'm not getting much out of the deal.
Oh, really? Place to live, fine clothes, anything you want?
What I want is to be paid for honest work instead of being paid for being your whore.
At least you know what you are. You get a cab, and you get back to the Red Lion and pack your things. You know, you used to be good for a few laughs. But I'm not amused anymore.
Miss Anderson, have you seen Mr. Kenley? There's a terrible row over at Lafayette Hall. Cook's gonna kill someone. I've gotta find him. It's the story he's been waiting for. I'll find him on the way.
Thank you.
reason I'm being hounded by the police every day. You never paid off the right people!
Don't listen to him, he's insane!
The final words of a dead man. If I don't get you, McCleary, one of my men will.
You made a big mistake today, Cook.
Me?
You're hit an officer of the law. I'll have the entire police force down here, and they'll tear this place apart for it by my
glory. Throw enough money their way, and they'll be in my pocket just like you.
Well, Mr. Garner knows how to treat a man with respect.
Garner knows how to make traitors out of worthless men like you.
No man is worthless if you can pay his price.
Get out of here, Garner.
I'll have a double whiskey, waiter.
I told you to get out. I don't serve colored trash.
I would watch my mouth, sir.
You are trash. You run a stinking, rotting place and call it a hotel, ruining every honest businessman in the ward.
So now you're an honest businessman? The only difference between the Red Lion and this hellhole is I don't try to hide what it is.
I told you to get out. I told you to get out! Somebody ought to kill you and do the world a favor.
If it's any consolation, sir, I don't like you either.
Oh! Gotta look out!
He won't shoot me. He'd have too many witnesses to pay off.
That is the dumbest thing I ever heard you say.
Selected residents of the capital city turned out in great number today to pay final tribute to the late Morris Harry Cook, one of the Eighth Ward's most respected residents. From early morning, there has been a stream of people coming and going to look upon the face of Harry, lying in state in a coffin of solid rosewood with a plethora of silver ornamentation. The deceased was dressed in his best suit of lavender trousers, black velvet coat, and a diamond stick pin as big as the end of your thumb.
Thank you, friends. Please, be seated. The soul of Mr. Harry Cook is resting in the bosom of the Almighty. And if he were here, he would be gladdened by the sight of so many friendly faces.
If he was here, there wouldn't be any reason for us being here.
Be respectful of the dead, you stupid Mick!
Oh, sure,
come on!
Dear friends, he was a good man, a great man, a friend to you gentlemen, a gentleman to you ladies, a defender of the weak, a benefactor for the...
Who the hell is he talking about?
Who's this hero that we're dragging?
You can fertilize a field with what he's saying.
They had better hurry up before the body starts decaying.
I just came here for the free lunch.
He had a heart readily touched by tales of woe. He had given money lavishly to the poor and the needy.
helped bury the dead of these poor folk when men who would have considered Harry Cook's touch contamination had turned coldly away.
If only he would have been canonized as saint!
And now a few words from his close friend and fellow entrepreneur, Mr. Alfred Garner.
Dear friends, we're gathered here, sad to say. We're here inside this hall to share this sad, sad day. The men are sorrowful, the women cry. We hope we'll meet our friend by and by. I would ask you all at this time to lend an ear to the message of comfort that will be offered by Sister Beulah.
You ought to try to smile, he'd want it so. Who would have thought it was his time to go? It really is a shame he had to die. When will we see our friend by and by? Let us raise all our voices up and sing. When St. Pete comes a knocking, there ain't no arguing. So beware, so prepare, that's the truth, ain't no lie. So we can see each other by and by.
Sister Beulah, thank you. Now, I would ask you all at this time. I'm continuing the ceremony.
I ain't done.
I would like to continue.
Well, you better be liking to let me continue. I was hired to sing a hymn, and I'm gonna sing it. So sit down and shut up. You sinner.
Yeah.
with the sweet talk, Garner. I ain't one of your lady friends.
Well, I would hardly consider you one of my own.
Just give me my money.
I seem to be a little short at the moment.
You seem to need your eyes examined. You got a lot of money in here. I ain't seen this much green since I left Atlanta.
Well, have you got what you want? Get out. Nice ceremony. Very touching, very touching.
What do you think you're doing?
Well, I'm just getting some of the back pay the man owed me. Tried to kill me, you know. He said I was the reason he was losing money. Called me a traitor for going to work for you. Anything you'd like in here?
You're a disgusting man, McCleary.
Oh, I see, and you're a saint just like our dear dead friend here, eh? Wasn't it lucky that the judge called it a accidental death?
That's what it was.
Gentlemen, they're going to be removing the casket presently. I suggest we postpone this conversation.
Never mind. You just come for one last look. God, good day, gentlemen.
I'm surprised you're here, Kenley.
I'm covering this as an obituary. That's all the writing I'm allowed to do for the paper now.
Mr. Fremont is an astute man. He knows where your true talents lie.
But I am watching everything that goes on in the ward. I plan on composing a book to let everyone...
And letting everyone in the state of Pennsylvania know what their capital city is really like. Mr. Kenley, I never thought of you as simple-minded. They already know. And they don't care. Mr. Cook will pass into historical oblivion. And Lafayette Hall will probably be turned into a rescue mission. So much for King Cook and his domain.
Funeral procession will never be forgotten. First came the brass band playing the death march, then the minister and pallbearers, and the hearse decorated with floral emblems. All this followed by 50 carriages containing the dead man's intimates and denizens from the underworld. Suit Harry like a pharaoh, inter him like the Inca. By the blessing of the priest and the bonhomie of the police, gather a group that nears the size of the lamenting for Lincoln. And afterwards, with every bottle and bet, the eighth will elevate him more than all the mayors.
Inter him like the Incas,
lamenting for Lincoln. Good God, to read this, Mr. Harrisburg just witnessed the funeral of the century.
Well, you have to admit, he was well-liked by a lot of people.
Yes, and a lot of people showed up at that carnival just to make sure the man was actually dead.
Admittedly, the article was well-written. Mm-hmm. That Kenley fellow certainly has a way with words. I might have to look into hiring him.
Do you plan on dying soon, Martin? He writes for the obituary page.
Speeches, Oliver. I meant write speeches for the upcoming election.
Oh, so you're planning on another term. Afraid your record won't speak for itself, eh? Hey?
Well, if that were the case, I wouldn't stand a chance of re-election in any of the 38 states.
Oh, good God, would any of us.
True. Oh. Good afternoon, Miss Cecilia. How wonderful it is to see you. I thought Miss Henderson had vacated the premises.
Oh, we had a long, long discussion about that. And now everything is back to the way it was. Isn't it, Cecilia?
If you say so, Oliver. I'm not interrupting some political business, am I?
Oh, contraire. We were merely just discussing the latest edition of The Patriot. Your young gentleman friend writes extremely well.
My young what?
Mr. Kenley. Mr. Wilson Kenley?
You remember him? You met him at Lafayette Hall just a week or so ago.
And spoke to him briefly and rather abruptly, as I recall. I wouldn't call him a friend or even an acquaintance.
Well, after all, Miss Cecilia, you are a young, attractive woman, and he certainly is a handsome...
Do you enjoy making trouble, Senator? I said I do not know the man.
Martin, when Cecilia speaks, it is with the truth. Now tell me, darling, what little gigols did we purchase for ourselves today?
A hat and a dress.
Well, you need not worry about Senator Delacourt. He means nothing by his remarks, do you, Martin?
Absolutely not, Mrs. Cecilia. My most humblest of apologies to you.
Come in, come in.
Oh, for the love of St. Michael. Senator, why aren't you down at the Senate chamber?
And a good afternoon to you, too, Clarence.
Skip the amenities, for God's sake. You need to get down to the Capitol. All hell's breaking loose down there.
Oh, don't tell me the governor has finally decided to resign.
Oh, I wish it was something as easy as that. No, no. Old Lady Doc and her cronies have busted into the chamber, and they're expounding on the evils of the war.
No, rabble-rousers. Well, that'll have no effect. Trust me.
With the killed in cold blood for all those people?
Yes, in front of all those people, all those witnesses. It was the court's ruling.
I don't care if God himself made the ruling. These people have had enough.
Well, I think it's just a few loose screws trying to get their way. Nothing will become of it.
Good Lord, Senator, they've got Mr. Fremont, they've got Dr. Calder, they've got Father Copenhagen, and half the congregation of the Hiscomona Synagogue.
Now, Clary, we'll handle this.
Handle it? For God's sake, how? You're going to pay off all these people and send them home, for God's sake? No, these people are out for blood, Senator, I'm telling you, and they don't care whose blood it is. His, yours, or mine.
Then you need to get over to the chamber and follow up on this, and you, please, Martin, get down to the mayor's office and have all these rebel-rousers arrested.
Well, he won't help us. What good will that do? He'll be afraid that they'll be after him.
The mayor? Oh, God, no, he's on our side.
And what makes you think that can't change? What makes you so sure he'll listen to you?
Because I pay him to listen to me. He's in my pocket. And if the 8th Ward goes down, so does he, so do I, so do everyone. And I have not wasted all these years to be destroyed by a gang of mealy mouthfuls. Now, McCleary, get the hell over to the chamber now. Martin, to the mayor's office. Cecilia, I might be gone for a while. I want you to stay here. Do not go out no matter what, understand?
I'm afraid that I'll join the protest against the ward or tell someone.
Shut up. You know very well that no one can know my involvement in the ward. You must understand that. Do you understand? You must stay here. Do not leave no matter what.
What if the newspapers get a hold of this information?
Oh, what if? That would mean that some of my closest friends can't be trusted. And I have several close friends. Now, I would consider you a very close friend. You are, aren't you?
Yes, I'm a friend.
And I care a great, great deal about my close friends, especially you. But at times like this, unfortunately, I care more for myself.
What were you like when you were young? You couldn't always have been this way. Cold, unfeeling, coarse, unyielding, cruel, demanding, never understanding of anyone other than you. What were you like when you were young? Were you ever kind? Though the thought is laughable, did you ever say a word that might display that you could be quite affable? Did you ever show a true and happy kind of smile? Something from your heart you far apart, even for a little while. Did you ever feel an honest, deep emotion? Did you ever look beyond your selfish pride for anyone's devotion? Were you ever rude? Maybe you were long ago.
A near riot broke out yesterday on Capitol Hill when the Senate session was interrupted by a reform group led by the socially prominent Mrs. Myra Lloyd Dock and Mr. Charles Fremont, editor of the Pennsylvania Patriot. The rioters were arrested by members of the police force and charged with disturbing the peace and illegal assembly. The entire group are being held until bail can be posted in the city jail.
Where could Warrior be? Should have been out hours ago.
You calm down. The worst of it is over.
The worst, he says. I don't know many things that are worse than being arrested in the Senate chamber, carted off like a common fellow in a paddy wagon, and thrown into the city jail.
Where you were held for a few hours.
24 hours constitutes more than a few.
And you live to tell the tale. May I shake your hand?
This is no time for humor, Jasper.
How's your mother managing?
Well, you know, Mother, she doesn't consider arrest any kind of setback. She regards it as a huge step toward her goal.
Which is the destruction of modern society.
Of all the humiliating experiences, spending the night behind prison bars. I couldn't even sleep for fear that someone would steal my shoes.
Spending time in the city jail has given us some insight as to what the residents of the 8th Ward go through on a regular basis. Why, we weren't even allowed to contact an attorney.
As if any attorney with half a brain would get involved in this.
I may bring a lawsuit against the police force. I could claim false arrest. After all, I was only exercising my right of free speech.
Free speech? I beg to differ with you. Bail for your little escapade was unreasonably high.
The judge was told to set that amount.
True, only demonstrates how far up the corruption in this city reaches.
You know, if you'd stuck to your original plan, none of this would have occurred. The demonstration was supposed to happen in less than a week. Why was there this rush to storm the Capitol?
Because of Cook's murder.
Murders and deaths are a daily occurrence in the war. Don't you remember the body of the young woman found at the Red Lion?
She died of smallpox. Nobody gave a whit about her, and the reveille barely even ceased. They simply bundled her off to a stuffy little room on the third floor, where she was quickly forgotten and died.
She didn't even have a decent funeral. They just stuck her in the body in the ground somewhere.
But this situation is something different. Cook was a prominent figure.
Oh, yes, a respected businessman. All my merchant friends run whorehouses.
The citizens of the city are concerned that the corruption is going to spread beyond the ward's boundaries. Mrs. Dock and I agreed that action had to be taken immediately.
So we end up in jail, and the real criminals in this matter just walk around as if nothing ever happened.
Well, you can count me out of any further actions the holy citizens of Harrisburg may have planned.
You can't quit now, Charles. None of us can. Did you see the faces of the good senators? The actions of the police? They're scared of us. They know that their days of power may be numbered.
Fremont, I think perhaps you've gone a little soft in the head.
Any government that allows the existence of such life as found in the 8th Ward is rotted and defective. Civil betterment is more than fine buildings, clean streets, and parks. It means civic purity. We must reorganize our efforts and wait until our misadventure of yesterday is a memory. Perhaps a week or two. And then we will strike again. And this time, we will not fail.
Friday, May 9th, 1877. It has been 1 week since the unfortunate Mrs. Myra Lloyd Dock and her reform group were unceremoniously carted off to jail. Mrs. Dock refused to speak to this reporter concerning the matter. Can it be that the efforts of the reformers have passed? As to life in the 8th Ward, all has returned to its normal state. It is as if last week's attempted action had never occurred.
Suicide today over at the Red Line.
Oi! What a horror! Tell.
seems a large black woman after an all-night wrestling match with dope and whiskey and who knows what else.
Oh, and probably other brands of sin.
Probably. Was feeling a little remorse, so she took a leap off a little balcony in the rear of the building. She landed on the large black man cleaning customers. When he got up and got his breath back, he ran down the street screaming,
Oh, Lord, I'm converted! I need to move!
Never to clean another cuspidor. Is he dead?
No, just dead drunk.
Must be Irish.
Come on, Mick, get up or I'll wheelbarrow you down.
Where? Look here. One of the city's finest, hard at work kicking a fella Irishman when he's down.
What do you say? We kick him around a bit and see how he likes it.
It's nice to know we're so well protected.
You've got me. Buy that bracelet for me.
Not today, Priscilla.
If not today, then when?
Not any day, I'm afraid. I'm bankrupt.
You're what?
It's only a matter of time before money ran out. It's all purchases you made.
Can I help it if I like nice things?
I'm not condemning you. Don't be this way, Prissy. We can still get married, move to a new place, and start life over again. After all, we still love each other.
Love each other? What makes you think I'm in love with you?
You're always saying it.
I'm always saying it because you want to hear it. I don't care a picayune for you, except as you can give me money. You're a fool if you think otherwise. When the money's gone, so am I.
You mean this was all a...
convenient arrangement. You got what you wanted, I got what I wanted. You ain't my first sucker, and you ain't gonna be my last. Get your hands off me.
And off flies the bird of prey to her next victim.
And a dream of love dies.
Again!
Gentlemen, it's a pleasure doing business with you as always. It's men like you who make men like me glad they are in business.
Well, Mr. Garner, it's men like us who make men like you rich.
Well, Stephen, it's so good to see you back from Philadelphia. Oh, and what a beautiful day it is to be in the ward on a fine morning like today. So what have you two been up to?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I'd say a little bit of this and
a little bit of that.
Actually, it's more like a lot of this and a whole lot of that.
Well, at least we heard the last of those do-gooders, didn't we? I mean, who would love to see this squalor torn down? Thank God. One full blessed week of complete silence.
Yes, things are back to normal and quiet in our little part of the world.
Yes.
If you ask me, too quiet. Oh. I wonder if Doc and her group of fanatics are really going to get away with getting rid of the Eighth Ward.
Oh, not to worry about it, Senator. I assure you. Garner's right. Relax. Look, business abounds in the ward, on every corner, in every shop, and at every hotel. It's a very healthy economy when so much money passes through so many hands directly into ours.
Giving us our own special brand of, shall we say, free trade?
Exactly. I pay my amount, who in turn pays the cop on the corner, who in turn talks to the alderman, who speaks to the mayor, who takes care of the judge. Isn't that easy? Easy picking all over town. Old opportunity is knocking. Just look around. On every corner there is some poor chap just waiting to be rough. To make yourself a fin
for everybody else you meet on the corner of the street is out to try and cheat. You are picking.
Oh my, it's such easy picking.
Go out, explore.
A little daring you and you two
can make a score.
So naive.
to get her twisty. They're eager to believe. Just tell them what you want to hear. Come across as real, sincere.
Take their dough and disappear fast as you can.
The robber bears have tons of riches. They made off you and I. Steal those rotten sons of bitches. Want those tons to multiply. So who's to blame the common man for working with success to grab his share of what's out there to try and feather his nest? Because he knows.
Their tail between their legs. It is my considered opinion that we have heard the last of these lunatics. Perhaps at last the Eighth Ward will be left in peace and its residents left to their own devices. The nerve of that man.
Myra, you mustn't be upset by all of this.
Oh, he can call me all the names he likes. What do I care? But how dare he say we have withdrawn and given up?
It's been a week since that unfortunate incident down Capitol Hill.
I'm sure everyone expected an immediate retaliation on our part. It didn't happen, therefore we are gone and forgotten.
Look at this. Another ward resident died today, murdered in cold blood.
Why do they waste the ink? Tell us the same thing day in and day out.
Another death, or suicide, or someone beaten senseless and left for dead. The whole Eighth Ward is going to hell in a handbasket.
There is not one vice, not one sin omitted from their daily lives. When is this going to come to an end?
Once they've killed each other off, then we'll have some peace and tranquility.
I tell you, we cannot let the sordid life in the ward continue. We must strike now.
What would you have us do?
What we've been planning to do for the past week. Go down there, fight for the rights of those people, the right to a better way of life.
I agree with Mrs. Dock, and I say that tonight is the night.
And I say we forget the whole thing. It will come to nothing. Nothing. Do you hear me?
Unless we're all arrested again.
Oh, that's not going to happen. This is going to be a complete surprise.
And what about the police?
What about them? They're not going to bother us.
And how do you know that? Is it a holiday for them?
No, the police are just never in the ward unless it's for a payoff.
Our way will be free and clear. No one can stop us from our holy mission. No one suspects. No one.
She's right. Word on the street is that we have given up after our last ignominious defeat.
Then it's perfection. They think we've lost our courage and our nerve.
But our resolve is stronger than ever. We shall see what happens. when the battle's won, and the song of their salvation they'll sing, when their lives are all laid bare, ripping them from Satan's snare. Then the souls made pure and holier than the bell of freedom will seeping through your skin at deadly rate. Such a lot of sin, no one's going to win. Such a lot of sin, you'll tear their house down, burn it to the ground,
they must forgive. Once you have completed this destruction, do you have a place where they can live? Maybe you can plant some trees and grasses, make a pretty park for eyes to see. Build another building for the Senate. Someone else can write their eulogy. Such a lot of sin. No one's going to win. You're here to condemn, but with their requiem, what will become of them? 50 years from now, or 100 more, the rich will still control and subjugate the poor. They will belittle them, and they will slam the door, and all the problems there, they will still ignore. A sin, you kill your brother, kill him on the ground on which you trod. Let him feel the power you are wielding, and you do it in the name of God. Such a lot of sin you are committing, living every day in hideous bliss, cheating all your friends and all your neighbors, every decent moral you dismiss. Such a lot of sin, no one's going to win. Homeless children looking for a warm place for the night. Many of the women's reputations promising an evening of delight. In the bars and brothels there are men who do not have a thought or give a damn. Drinking and carousing is a pleasure, and it is the mark of a true man. Such a lot of sin, no one's going to. Man's inequality to man. The battle is now over, and the winner's been declared. A senseless waste of energy, with tempers hotly flared. No one's going to win.
Sticking your nose in something that is none of your business.
Exactly. How dare you jeopardize everything we have worked for?
I dare to do it because everything that you do, that I'm trusting
to hear your opinion. And it will be a cold day in hell before anybody ever sees another word of yours in print.
Do you see this, Mr. Fremont? These pages contain everything I have written about this place and the people in it. I am going to tell everyone the truth about this place.
This little book has all the facts.
I'll be taking that from you now, Mr. Freeman.
You can't do that.
Or can do, have done. I intend to use this little book as evidence against you for inciting a riot.
There's no riot here. Nothing happened.
That's right.
Of course not. The police force arrived just in time to prevent anything. Show Mr. Kenley here to his new residence at the city jail.
That's just where he belongs.
Now, we can get on with our plan.
Oh, no, folks. No, you best be going home now.
Oh, but Sergeant, really?
Oh, no, missus. You best be going home to bed. There won't be nothing happening here in the 8th Ward tonight or any night as long as I am in charge. Go on home now, people. And listen, stay out of the ward. It ain't a fit place for man or beast.
McCleary, give me that book. There's weeks of work in those pages. Give it to me.
Oh, then it ought to make for some very interesting reading. Hey, take very good care of our prisoner here. We wouldn't want to see nothing happen to him now, would we?
Cleary, give me my book!
Best calm down and not give me any problems.
Why? What do you do to me? What?
How's that, starters? We wouldn't want you to get hurt. People might start rumors about police brutality.
Leave him be.
He didn't do nothing.
truth.
No one cares. Mind your business.
This is our business. Ain't it, Mr. Schlosser?
Most certainly. Clear out of here, all of you.
Let him go.
He broke the law. He is my prisoner.
You're ours now.
Say, you never know what the little idiot might have put in there about us. Why, that book could...
But shut up, McCleary! What do you think, Senator?
I think McCleary's right. I think this little book here could cause us all some very serious harm.
Here she is, Senator. Priscilla made it sound like a matter of life or death. Are you all right, Oliver?
Do you know what this is?
It's a book of some kind.
Yes, it is a book of some kind. It's from your reporter friend, Mr. Kendall.
I wouldn't call him a friend. I barely know him. I barely have spoken to him.
Oh, I see. Then I suppose, Cecilia, he refers to all his friends as a ravishing rogue. Care to explain?
There's nothing to explain. This is something he's created in his own mind.
Oh, I see. I saw Cecilia today, and just for a moment, the world was a much better place. Words from your new love?
Let me see that.
What? So you can refresh your memory? You have deceived me for the last time.
Not my lover. Nothing happened between us. You're being ridiculous.
I'm ridiculous. You're ridiculous if you think I'll be cockled by some fool. Some fool like this who'll see me destroyed. God only knows what else you told him about me.
I haven't said anything, I swear.
I swear I could kill you where you stand. Kill you. But that would be just too good. I'm gonna send you back to the squalor from where you came. Back to the slums, and so you can pick you up and take care of you, like I did. You ungrateful bitch.
You're better off without him. Now you and Kenley can be together.
You don't believe me either, do you? Kenley doesn't figure into this. No one does.
I'm all alone again. No one there to make me feel as if I had no right to feel a thing. I'm on my own again. No one there to answer to. No one has me dangling on a string. Free and independent, released and on my own. Who would know the world would be like this when you're alone?
station, man. If you're in there, there ain't much chance of living through it.
Oh, God. You can't do it.
What can't be? You dragged me down here because you said something about Cecilia.
We found her body! I need somebody to help me take her out. Come on!
No, no, don't.
Please. Say it. Say it. I need to know.
I know, but you
can't. I need Tina, please. Greensboro did this. I heard him talking around. He got a hold of your diary and read it. What I wrote, it's just make-believe. She doesn't love me. She doesn't even know how I feel about her.
She told him that.
Greensboro wouldn't listen. He wanted to get even with Cecilia for taking up with you. He wanted to hurt her like she had hurt him. He knew this was the place to do it. He started those fires, knowing she would show up.
Why in God's name would she come here?
She doesn't live here. She's a place on the other side of
no.
But her brother does. She keeps a flat here for him. Greensboro knew about the boy. If he killed the kid, Cecilia, she'd get what she deserves. Think she enjoyed being Greensboro's mistress?
Get out of the way!
Take care of the kid.
Somebody get her some help!
Nothing can be done for her now.
Miss Henderson. Cecilia.
Rose. My name is Rose. That's what you called me in your book.
You weren't supposed to see that.
But I did. All of it. It's nice to know I mattered to someone.
You do. Cecilia. I love you.
Always the writer. Always looking for the right words to say. And your words are perfect. Wilson, you need to know you will always be my man of letters.
Cecilia. Never ends the way we want it to. Your business is done here, Kenley. Go home.
I belong here.
You're not one of us. You could never be.
Thank you.
coming in and witnessing the Bloody Eighth. It's nice to see a musical about Harrisburg, even though it is a dark musical. We're very happy to be able to produce this and present it with so many, many hands, and it's taken over 2 years to get up here on stage, and we want to thank everybody involved. And thank you, and tell your friends it runs next Friday evening, next Saturday afternoon, Saturday evening, and closes Sunday afternoon, and we would love to see it filled up. Thank you so much. Have a great afternoon, and God bless the USA. Good night, everybody.